Dickinson.
Imagine you, lady. Yeah, that's right.
Well, after DeMott, you decide to have another crack at being a professional comedian. Your persistence pays off, and you're given a chance down the bill at the old Collins Music Hall in 1946. You get music hall bookings up and down the country, and in 1947, a big break in a charity show at London's Victoria Palace with Laurel and Hardy, top of the bill. Now, your rise up the bill begins the following year when someone pops into the theatre to catch your act, a very influential impresario then and now, Lord Delphont.
Hello, Norman.
Hello, Bernie.
You played an important part in my professional life in the world of entertainment. It all started as far back as the late 1940s, when I was presenting some of the famous American headliners who were making their first appearances in this country after the war at the London Casino. However, I was looking to include unknown English artists to be given an opportunity. My very close colleague for well over 40 years, Billy Marsh, who is your agent and with you, begged me to put you into one of these programs. Yes, I said, okay, but he can only be allowed 8 minutes as I had a very big program. On the opening night, however, you did half an hour and you absolutely stopped the show. You are a legendary British star that will entertain the public for years to come. Thanks, Norman.
Thank you, Lord Delphont. Well, your career was taking off, yet amazingly, you'd yet to invent that cloth-capped character in a too-tight suit. Now, that happened in Scarborough one day when the magician on the bill, the late and much missed David Nixon, asked you to help him by pretending to mess up one of his tricks. You would pretend to be a customer coming up from the audience, and you went out and bought the outfit, didn't you?
Yes, yes.
What did it cost you?
30 bob for the suit and a shilling for the cap.
And even today, you wear that suit in cabaret with your longtime partner, Tony Fain, and it's that buttoned-up suit, cloth cap askew in 1953, you endear yourself into the nation in the film Trouble in Store. The first of 19 hilarious movies over two decades which bring comparisons with the early Chaplin. 1955 sees you in this one, and the title song was a big hit, too.
He's the man of the moment, the man of today. If he's the man of the moment, I'm happy to say. But he's not here for the moment, a man on his way. Just the man of the moment for today.
And for our man of the moment tonight, they're right here, always the girls of the moment, the Beverly Sisters. Oh.
Man of the moment, the man of today. This is the man of
happy birthday.
Well, hello.
Lovely to see you.
Girls, I understand there was, in fact, quite a moment. Have it. Sit down, Owen. Tell us about another moment, Gerard, at that charity concert at the London Coliseum.
Well, that was 34 years ago.
Oh, my goodness.
Now, it was a very swanky gala occasion, all international celebrities, for the Lynmouth Flood Disaster Fund, you must remember. Yeah. We remember, anyway. And we just finished our act. We finished our act and went running off for our applause, and I slipped on a custard pie, went flying, hit my head on the microphone on the floor, and went out totally cold. Well, it put Norman in a dilemma, because the opening of Norman's act, you walk on and do a spectacular fall.
Yes. Right, right. But this moment proved that Norman Wisdom was a very big man, because without any hesitation...
He did a most beautiful thing. He strode out onto that vast stage, this little character with his little shrunken suit and cap on, and he scooped Babs up in his arms and gallantly carried her off.
He did.
Well, thank you for the very interesting.
The man of the moment.
By the mid-50s, Norman, put him down. You were certainly going up in the world, and appropriately enough, going up in the world was the title of your smash hit 1956 movie, in which you played a window cleaner who falls in love with a girl who's a maid.
I've a feeling of being so up in the world when I'm walking out with you. Up in the world is the feeling I get even talking about you. I can say that.
Well, Norman, looks like the window cleaner and the maid had a head for heights.
I didn't. I never told you, did I, Norman?
I actually suffer from vertigo.
You're a fictional maid who became a real-life countess you haven't met for 25 years. Former actress Maureen Swanson, the Countess of Dudley. Maureen, you must still be surprised you survived that scene, suffering as I know you do from vertigo.
Yes, I do suffer very badly from that.
I wonder why you kept holding on to me.
But the moment you started to sing to me, Norman, my fears were gone, and I consider it was the Norman conquest of my fears.
But Maureen, there was another hidden horror, wasn't there, as far as you were concerned?
Yes, rodents. Except, of course, water rats. I'm absolutely petrified of them. But, Norman, you had the bright idea, didn't you, of producing that little hamster, Harold? Mm. And I had to hold it and love it. Well, all I can say is that I should have been given an Oscar for bravery. So, but it is wonderful for me to be here tonight.
Thank you. Maureen Swanson, Countess of Dudley. Thank you. Thank you. Well, for all your cinema success, Norman, you're always in great demand for the stage, including, of course, the world-famous London Palladium. Two great comedy talents there, and tonight that other decorator is taking a holiday break with his wife at her home in Puerto Rico, but not even the in-laws can keep him from the nearest golf course. Your old pal, Bruce Forsyth.
Hello, Eamon, and hello there, Norman. Well, now, when This Is Your Life do these film bits from overseas, the people always say, I'm sorry I can't be with you tonight. Well, I'm not. I'm not a hypocrite. No, I mean, here I am at Hyatt's Dorado Beach in Puerto Rico, probably one of the finest golf and tennis and hotel resorts in the world. So, I mean, I've just had 18 holes of golf. I'm just going to have a pina colada, if you'll pardon the expression. And then after that little light lunch, maybe another 9 holes of golf or a little bit of tennis. And then dinner under the stars. So how can I say, I'm sorry, I can't be with you? But what I can say is, Norman, I hope you're having a wonderful, wonderful evening. And you know, you're someone I will always, always admire. So have a marvellous time. Oh, and Norman, if you decide to do the dance at the end of the show, make sure that Eamon does the leading. He's very touchy about that. Well, I think that's about all. I'm sorry you can't be here with me. Bruce Forsyth, News at 10, Puerto Rico. Oh, no, wait a minute. No, Bruce Forsyth, This Is Your Life. Puerto Rico. Do you like the outfit? I'm flying the flag. Go out on the legs, Carl. Go out on the legs. That's where the action is. All right.
Thank you. Bruce Forsyth in Puerto Rico. Norman, in the early 70s, you played in Summer Season with a rising young comedy star from Liverpool who used to watch your act from the wings.
And to me, pal, you'll always be the greatest.
In those days, star in name only, but today, star indeed, Freddie Starr.
No.
Oh, yeah. Mr. Grimsdale.
No. I'm innocent.
I know, Freddie, that you found his particular brand of comedy quite an inspiration, didn't you?
Yeah. I based myself on Norman, you see, and I've always admired him brilliantly. After being on stage, if sometimes you got a duff audience, you know, like we got tonight. I'm only joking. Shut up. I'd come up on the stage to him.